is in glory.
Christ has come down from heaven. Receive him. Christ is now on earth. Exalt him.
O you earth, sing to the Lord.
O you nations, praise him in joy, for he has been glorified.
Praise the Lord, sun and moon. Praise the Lord, all shining stars.
Praise the Lord, highest heavens, and all the waters above the heavens.
Let them praise the name of the Lord, who commanded and they were created,
who established them forever and ever, and fixed their bounds which cannot be passed.
Praise the Lord for the earth, sea monsters, and all beasts.
Fire and hail, snow and smoke, stormy winds fulfilling God's command.
Mountains and all the hills, fruit trees and all cedars.
Beasts and all cattle, creeping things and all birds.
Kings of the earth and all peoples, princes and all rulers of the earth.
Young men and maidens together, old men and children.
Let them praise the name of the Lord, whose name alone is exalted, whose glory is above earth and heaven.
God has raised up a horn for his people, praise for all his faithful ones, for the people of Israel who are near their God. Praise the Lord.
This is the word of our Lord.
Thanks be to God.
This is the time which we invite our children to come forward as we share our children's distant land coming to worship. and Jesus is Lord.
Now that's a wonderful story, isn't it?
Yep.
Jesus, whose name is Jesus because he's going to save us. He's known as Emmanuel because he means God is with us. But as I look at these wonderful figures that help us tell that story, I'm not seeing a figure that should be there. I feel like there's something missing from this nativity scene. Any idea what that might be? I mean, again, because it's a lovely nativity scene, it tells a wonderful story, but there's someone else who should be in that story. Well, it's something of a trick question. But the ones who should be in that story and the ones who are a part of that story are you and me. That sounds kind of strange. But you and me become a part of this story. Because remember, the Bible tells us the Word of God became flesh and dwelt with us. Jesus is named Jesus because it means God saves us. We also know Jesus as Emmanuel because that's another word that means God with us. So, brothers and sisters, we're a part of this story. Even though you don't see us in lovely porcelain figures, even though you don't see us on this table, we share this story because now we're a part of the story. And we belong to this wonderful scene that tells of God's love for all his children. It tells how God is coming to dwell with us. So I'm grateful for the scene, for the story it tells, for the reminder of God's love for us. But I'm hoping from this day forward, as we look at these beautiful nativity scenes, that not only do we see shepherds, and wise men, and animals, Mary, Joseph, and Jesus, but in some way we also see ourselves gathered into the story of God's love for us. I'm going to ask us to pray, and I'll say a few words at the end to pray with you, pray at you, to the children's church. We thank you, O God, for Jesus, for your love, for your being with us. And we thank you for this wonderful story, how you love us and are with us now and always. Thank you, children. Again, Merry Christmas. Happy New Year. we share from the New Testament. The letter to the Hebrews, the second chapter, verses 10 through 18, in which there is reference still to Christ coming to dwell with us. Let us hear the word of God. For it was fitting that he, for whom and by whom all things exist, in bringing many children to glory, should make the pioneer of their salvation perfect through suffering. For he who sanctifies and those who are sanctified have all one origin. That is why he is not ashamed to call them brothers and sisters, saying, I will proclaim your name to my brothers and sisters. In the midst of the congregation, I will praise thee. And again, I will put my trust in him. And again, here I am, in the children God has given me. Since therefore the children share in flesh and blood, he himself likewise partook of the same nature, that through death he might destroy him who has the power of death, that is, the devil, and deliver all those who through fear of death were subject to lifelong bondage. For surely it is not with angels that he is concerned, but with the descendants of Abraham. Therefore he had to be made like his brothers and sisters in every respect, so that he might become a merciful and faithful high priest in the service of God, make expiation for the sins of the people. For because he himself has suffered and been tempted, he is able to help those who are tempted. This is the word of our Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Well, this may be that Sunday on which we find ourselves envying the shepherds and wise men, envying perhaps even Mary and Joseph. You see, it appears that for us, Christmas is over in so many ways. Christmas Eve services, candlelighting, beloved hymns, and scripture. All seems to be behind us. All is drawing back to normal, whatever normal may be. But for those who occupy the story of the birth of Jesus as found in the Bible, what's difficult to think of life ever being the same for them. The shepherds, we are told, run from Bethlehem, tell everyone of what they have experienced. The wise men return home, but they know. They have worshipped, they have given gifts to the newborn king, their lives can never be the same. As for Mary and Joseph, well, they are new parents. Their lives are changed more than a little by this. But to be parents of the one who is to save God's people, to be parents of the long-awaited Messiah, finally given by God, what can this do to someone's life? You see, we may envy these who were at the first Christmas. Their lives are so changed by angel visits, angel singing, by the giving and receiving of gifts, a brilliantly shining star. From that day forward, life can never be the same for these persons. We have welcomed the newborn king, but do our lives look substantially different today than they did, say, last Sunday? Do our lives look different now than they did on December the 24th? Or do we now simply go back to those pre-Christmas days? True, we exerted much time, much energy, much money in preparation for Christmas Day. But do our lives just now simply revert to normal? Now, don't misunderstand. I'm not suggesting our celebration of Christmas was unenjoyable. May have been the best one yet. You may have enjoyed family gathering as never before. May have eaten a meal which you're still trying to recover. May have received the gift you're still going to cherish all your days. Your heart may have thrilled at being with children and grandchildren. May have been the most wonderful time of the year for you. But it's past.
What now?
Not only this, we didn't even see Jesus, did we? It's true, we sang hymns. We read the scriptures. We celebrated the Nativity, held the Christmas Eve services, lighted the candles. But we didn't see him. Didn't touch him, didn't expectation, we still didn't see him. So really, how are our lives significantly impacted? Have you not encountered in any practical fashion the one whose birth we proclaim? Does it sound irreverent to ask that? Inappropriate at this time and place? Well, if it does, the good news for all who ask such questions is we're not the first to do so. You see, we share this morning scripture from the book we know as Hebrews. I know it's not the most familiar of biblical writings. They are toward the end of the Bible mixed up with all those equally unfamiliar writings. We wonder, who are these Hebrews? How does they matter to us? And read through this writing and find that it's really not a letter, and it's definitely not a gospel. Hebrews is more of a sermon, an oration. Well, given all of this, what appeal could this writing known as Hebrews have for us? I mean, wouldn't it have made more sense at this time to have preached from more familiar territory, such as the gospel? Is it familiar territory the better route to go this morning? Why struggle with rugged, unfamiliar terrain you rarely travel? We do so because this territory is really where we find ourselves this morning. This morning, you and I may find ourselves struggling as did those who first heard these words of Hebrews. You see, the audience of these words, they were called to believe in Jesus. They were called to believe the Savior's been born, called to believe the long-awaited Deliverer is here, called to believe the one who freed them, healed them, made them new, finally arrived, called to believe all of this. They believed. They sang the songs of faith. They heard the scripture. They gathered for worship. Their lives have really known little change. Still suffering at the hands of oppressors, still living as a struggling minority, still suffering as those on the outside, still living as those whose lives have derived little measurable benefit from accepting Christ. Folks, we get that message. You and I may ask as well, really, are our lives all that different from when they were before welcoming Christ just a few days ago? The Hebrews ask, in a sense, what difference has Jesus made? Is it too irreverent for us at least to understand that question, to ask, well, on this side of Christmas, having welcomed the Christ child, are our lives different? Let's be honest, they're not asking too much, are they? They're simply asking to know that they're not alone in their lives. They're asking for the assurance that there is one who walks with them, that there is one who understands their struggles and trials. They're asking for the companionship of one who understands. And that's not too much to ask. It didn't seem to be too much to ask for a certain woman I visited at a hospital in Richmond several years ago. I was a seminary student, serving a summer internship at Richmond Memorial Hospital. I remember entering this woman's room. I really knew little about her. I did know she was the wife of a minister. It was evident as I entered her room that she was in discomfort. Before I could even speak a greeting to this woman, to this wife of a Christian pastor, she turned to me. She said, "God seems so far away." Was it too much for her to ask for the assurance of one who walks with her at that time? Perhaps you're remember seeing on TV just a few years ago an unusual series of commercials. Commercials that more than once got my attention. The commercials were for Kleenex tissues. The setting for these commercials was in the midst of an urban setting, perhaps downtown or at a busy crossroads. A gentleman sits in a chair opposite the couch. On the couch sits a man or woman, depending upon the commercial. A man or woman who has taken the occasion simply to sit and to talk, to share about some significant matter in life. The gentleman who sits in the chair is one who looks kind of astral, counselor type. He kindly and graciously listens, saying not a word. Those who sit on the couch speak to him, dab their eyes with Kleenex as they speak. The commercials even promoted a website, letitout.com. I enjoyed these commercials. I enjoyed the commercials because of this image of taking the ministry of conversation. Listen, beyond the walls of buildings and churches, taking that ministry literally to the streets. It's one reason I love these commercials. Another reason I love them, because by setting before us this image of a gentleman who simply sits in his chair, listening to those persons who may pass by, I am reminded of the gift of listening and how rare a gift it is for someone simply to do more than listen. And I see something of the gospel in those commercials. I see something of the letter in the Hebrews to those commercials. Because what I see in those commercials is the assurance that there is at least one at least one who listens to us, at least one who has time for us. This message conveyed in these commercials is the message of Hebrews. There is one who dwells with you. There is one who is made like you in every respect. There is one who has all the time in the world for you, says this writer. But there was also a Union Seminary in Richmond several years ago, a professor of pastoral care named William Oglesby. Oglesby, in fact, was a pioneer in the field of pastoral care, one of the first who actually served on a seminary faculty in that capacity of pastoral care. So when Oglesby set up his office, he set up the office from scratch. There's no one there he could follow. He didn't inherit any furnishings. He had to make do with an old desk and office chair. He brought in an old lamp or two not being used at home. He also set in his office a few other items so as to personalize the space. As for a place where students and others could sit when they came to talk with him, well, the best Oglesby could do was an old chair he had at home. He had forgotten the chair's origins, knew it had seen better days, but he still believed it would serve the purpose of welcoming visitors to come sit in his office. Well, the chair did this for many years. When the time came for Oglesby to move to a nicer, more spacious office, he took with him his chair. He couldn't bring himself to part with it. And even though the chair embarrassed his wife, she would speak unkindly of the chair from time to time, he still did not part with it. The chair had something of a bed ruffle around the bottom of it. The ruffle would come loose, need to be re-secured now and again, no big deal. The material on the chair's cushions became worn and frayed, a little patch in here and there gives a new life. And a protruding nail or tack in the chair's frame was going to simply bend or cover that thing. It'll protect the one who sits in it. Yes, this chair invited some friendly ridicule from other faculty, but it was being enough to be done with. In fact, there were those times when Oglesby would be in his office by himself. The day was quiet, but he would arise from behind his desk and go sit in that chair. He would do this, he said, because he knew no one really wanted to sit in this chair. Not because the chair had become unsightly and worn, but because to sit in that chair indicated some circumstance of need or helplessness for the person sitting there. You see, from that chair, one would speak of problems at school or at home. From that chair, one would speak of concerns, even doubts, about his or her call ministry. From that chair, students would weep as they feared letting their loved ones down. No one wanted to sit in this chair, said Oglesby. So he found it necessary at times to go sit where no one wanted to sit, to run his thumbnail down the groove that anxious students over the years had worn in the arm of that chair. For the sake of his ministry, he needed to put himself in their place. For our sake, Jesus now puts himself in our place. He knows what it's like sit where we sit. It's not an experience in our lives he doesn't know. Our sorrows, our joys, our tears, our laughter, our hopes, our fears, our victories, our defeats, all known by Jesus, made like us in every respect. The Jesus of Bethlehem's manger leaves the manger, leaves Bethlehem. He does so in order to walk with us, to dwell with us, even to sit with us. This being the Sunday after Christmas, we'll sing a little more than we are accustomed to. So we stand and sing part of the carol.
Thank you.
his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
As you stand, let us welcome one another as we pass the peace of Christ, gathered and singing of the holy.
So
and enlarge any prayers at this time. As I name various petitions of prayer, I will include each of the words, Lord, in mercy. I invite you to respond, hear our prayer. I invite you to name as well as concerns that might help us speak in this time of prayer. Let's go to God's prayer. Lord, you visit us, come and sit with us in the most intimate and vulnerable, risky of passions, such as your love for us. We pray, Lord, that we have made room for you to come and stay. And we pray that even as we move forward from Christmas Day, you will carry with us the Christmas message of your love, your presence, Emmanuel, your saving us from our sins. May this message be the one which guides us, strengthens us, heals us, gives us peace this day and into a new year. Help us, Lord, to let our light shine for your sake, remembering that you are the light of the world, and the light has come to illuminate our darkness. Lord, in your mercy, hear us, Lord, as we pray. For the people of this congregation, Lord, in your mercy,
I'm
hiding his place is with and dwell with us. In the name of God the Father, God the Son.